For Krumah Media's Polity, I'm Sash Nimuli. Author Stembiso Msomi joins me to discuss his book, Mmusi Maimane, Prophets or Puppets. The title of your book is Mmusi Maimane, Prophets or Puppets. In what sense could DA leader Mmusi Maimane be described as a prophet, and in what sense could he be described as a puppet?
Although the title came up with the publishers, but the idea was, you remember that when it first came out and when people learned that he had been a lay preacher working for a church organization, there were questions about whether he was coming into politics because he's a religious leader. So we used the term prophet to play around that idea of someone coming from the religious side of things, and also just looking forward the future, because I mean there are lots of problems that South Africa is encountering right now. So people are looking at who's going to lead us out of the problems that we're facing. So the question was whether Mmusi is that person. Is he the prophet who's going to lead us out of the crisis, or is he a puppet?
Can you briefly give us background to Mmusi Maimane? Where did he come from and grow up? How did he get involved with politics?
He grew up in Dobsonville, a township in Soweto. It used to be, I think, part of Rudeport in the past, but in 1994 it then became part of Soweto. A very political township. I mean, there are lots of activists who came from there. So I would think his interest in politics started at a very young age, even though he was not actively political. But I mean, with Mandela coming out of jail, when Mandela came out of jail, Mmusi was 10. But around 91, 92, in that area, Dobsonville, there was a hostel. So there was a lot of conflict between ANC supporters in the township and the hostel dwellers. And at Dobsonville, I think it was called Hostel One. So I think he would have been aware that something is happening and got interested in politics.
He writes in the book that no one in the group of journalists I was in took former DA leader Helen Zille seriously when she claimed that Mmusi Maimane would be a household name. Why do you think this was the case at the time?
Because, I mean, over time, you go back to the days when the DA was the DP. There was the leader, Seremane, who a lot of people were saying, because he was one of the prominent leaders of the DA at the time, that he would probably be the future, the first black DA leader. There have been other people. I mean, later on you even had Mamphela, who was coming through to form some form of an alliance with the DA. So there had always been this attempt by so-called white parties to have black leaders coming through their system. So, and they will fizzle away over time. So everyone assumed that, at least in the group of people that I was in, the assumption was that Mmusi was just another attempt. In fact, it was just an attempt to win Johannesburg, the way we saw it. We didn't even imagine that he will grow to become the party's leader. So it was like, okay, the DA controls Cape Town, they want to take a second major city, it's Johannesburg. They think they can never win Johannesburg with a white candidate, so they had to go into the white community. And that is what we were thinking at the time, that this is what is going on. So it was really surprising to see him grow and to become a leader this early.
Helen Zille said Mmusi Maimane has the leadership qualities, the vibrancy, the perseverance, and the will to lead. Do you agree with this statement?
I think it's still too early in a way, because I mean, really, he's been a leader for just a year. But if you're looking at what he has done, I mean, the achievements that they've had in this election just show you that she saw something in there, and he is talented, he is courageous. I mean, it must have been a very difficult decision for him to join the DA. I mean, because of the history of the country, of course, the DA coming from the DP and with their alliance they formed with the Nets, a lot of people in townships have over time seen them as parties that are there to maintain the old apartheid status quo, in a way that they were there to protect white privilege. So people tended to be hostile to parties like the DA. So even if you supported them, it's something that you don't generally express. So when it gets to a point where Mmusi goes, he joins and he becomes a leader, it shows something about his leadership quality.
Maimane received the title Obama of Soweto. Can you tell us about this and its significance?
Yes, well, originally it was from the campaign that they ran in 2011 for Johannesburg, which a lot of people thought what the DA is trying to do is to come up with their own Obama. I mean, the tours he used to take in the townships, his ability to deliver great speeches. So I think even the imaging that they used was very close to Obama images. They were obviously inspired by what had happened in the US with Obama coming from nowhere to rise to become the US president, and they thought maybe they could do the same thing in Johannesburg. But then the opponents of the DA then used that to mock him in a way, to say, well, this guy thinks he's Obama, he's Obama of Soweto. And then over time, it went to as far as, I think even CNN called him that.
Take us through your research process for this book.
Most of it was just following him at rallies. Well, I did have a sit down with him, explained what the project was going to be about. Following him at meetings, talking to people around him and trying to talk to people that he grew up with, because I was not really interested in the political aspects, in writing about him, the political leader. I wanted to understand where he came from, and I wanted to know from people around which he grew, because there were lots of assumptions. I also had lots of assumptions that, okay, here's this young guy, probably came from Ivory Tower School, he probably grew up in the suburbs, doesn't understand where South Africa has been through the struggle and all of that, and he's just doing this because he has an opportunity to be a successful politician. And then you start talking to people he grew up with, and you start realizing that he's always been asking questions about what's happening in society. He's always been interested in a way in politics and, social development as a whole. He's always shown signs of leadership from the time when he was involved in sports, trying to introduce different sporting codes in his township, where, a lot of people only played soccer. He loved soccer like every other township kid would. So it was that kind of research, talking to those people and then talking to people in the DA about when he came through and whether they ever suspected that he would rise so fast within the party ranks, which he did.
In the book, you write that given South Africa's past, it is no surprise that identity politics remains a profitable political enterprise. Can you explain why you think this is?
Yes, over time, before 94 and post 94, identity politics has been their politics. You are almost born into a political position, and then over time you may then refine your views and change, but it was almost as if it was natural that you would be a black person would belong to these parties, a white person would belong to party X or party Y. So, well, these elections now that we've just had are showing that that may be changing, that the country is changing, that people are now talking about issues, and that the loyalty to the political party is changing. But at the time when I wrote the book, it was mainly just looking at, if you looked at most South Africans who come from minority communities will vote for parties like the DA, and then the vast majority of South Africans who tend to be black tended to vote for the ANC, a bit of the EFF and the other smaller parties.
Even though the label is often misunderstood and often contested, the DA seems to position itself as a liberal party. Do you think South African voters will support a liberal party, and do you think Maimane is liberal?
I think he has liberal beliefs. I think he is mostly liberal. But I think in South Africa, if you look over time, parties that are purely one ideology have not really succeeded. You can look at the DP in its various forms, whether it is the PFP or the parties before it. they really never dominated South African politics when they were just pure ideological. The same thing on the left. I mean, if you look at the parties to the left of the ANC, you look at the Communist Party, for instance, that when it was just pure socialist party with no involvement with the liberation movement, they didn't really have much of an impact. The same thing with Pan-Africanist theory. So I think ideology is important, but it's not the main feature. So what you find over time is that parties that tend to have influence in South Africa, they mix and match from different ideological backgrounds. So I would say there are elements of liberalism which are dominant, as the DA comes from there, but there is some also elements of social democracy that we are seeing coming through as the DA grows.
As a black journalist, why was it important for you to write this book? And what do you think your readers will take from this book?
First, I believe that we all, because we come from different backgrounds, we all come with different perspectives, that will all enrich South Africa in terms of how we see our country, where we come from and where we're going. It was really worrying. There was a debate that we had with some of the colleagues, I think around 2013 when Mandela passed on, and we looked at what has been written about Mandela, a great leader, and you found that black voices were missing. And well, a lot of people will criticize publishers and say publishers don't want to take our proposals. But I was of the view that maybe we are not taking the initiative. We need to get into the debate. You find, for instance, with a lot of black reporters, they break a lot of political stories. So they are the ones who are the first ones to know if there are coalition talks between the DA and the EFF, or the ANC and the EFF. But they never really do a lot of analysis. And in book form, that's an opportunity for you to do the analysis, to give some opinionated views of what is going on. So my view was that if we start getting involved in that debate, we may help enrich South Africa in terms of understanding where we come from and where we are going.
After your detailed research and work in writing this book, what is your conclusion? Is Mmusi Maimane a prophet or a puppet?
I think it's up to the reader. I think the answer is really complicated. But my view is that he's no puppet. That even if there were people who thought maybe if we put him there, he will do as we wish, I think he is his own man. I mean, if you look at his life, if you look at a very young age, Mmusi was able to move away from the church organization that his whole family belonged to, and he decided he charted his own path. If you look at over time, that he's never been afraid of coming up with new ideas. And how he handled, I know he's criticized a lot, but how he handled the whole racism debacle towards the end of last year in the DA convinced me that actually, okay, it may be the history of the organization, where it comes from, and maybe the makeup of membership, but he does have a vision of some sort of where he wants to take the organization. And he'll be a very fascinating politician to watch over the next few years, considering that he's only 35, 36.
That was author Stembiso Msomi discussing his book, Mmusi Maimane, Prophets or Puppets?